Greetings and welcome to Jesse I Interviews. My name is Jesse I, but that probably won't come as a big surprise to most of you. But for those who don't know, this podcast is essentially a platform for me to showcase all the various interviews that I've conducted with reggae and dancehall artists, musicians and producers over the last few decades, and I produce it on the unceded lands of the Wurundjeri Woi Wurrung people of the Kulin Nation. They are the original inhabitants of the lands here in Melbourne, Australia, where I live and work. I want to pay my respects. This episode features a man who is no stranger to Melbourne, Stranger Cole. In fact, he'd be in the running for the artist who's performed here the most over the years, though I think nobody will ever beat Mad Professor on that front. This interview comes from his second time in Melbourne back in March 2011, when he performed at the Melbourne Ska and Rocksteady Review with local band The Moonhops. It's a live studio interview broadcast on PBS FM on my weekly program Babylon Burning. As always, the interview itself is completely unedited, but I'll trim most of the music in between the two interview halves, mostly because of copyright concerns. The interview also includes the Canadian music historian and DJ Moss Raxlen, whose name I did stumble on in the interview. I think I accidentally spoonerized his first name with his last, and he was quick to correct me, as you'll hear. Let's do it. Jesse I interviews one of the real veterans of Jamaican music, Stranger Cole, back in March 2011. Yes, you're on 106.7 PBS FM. The show is called Babylon Burning. My name is Jesse I. Right now, I'm very happy to welcome into the studio a man known as Stranger Cole. He just told me his real name is Wilburn Cole. Welcome to the studio, my friend.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here.
Of course, you're no stranger to Melbourne. You've been here before. It wasn't long ago, just last year.
Yes, I was here last year playing with about a 25 to 30 piece band at the same corner hotel. Yep. Yes, where I'm going to be playing tonight.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, we're very happy to have you in the studio, of course. It's not every day that we get a real legend of Jamaican music in the studio. And we're just playing some of your classic tunes there. We just heard Bangarang for Bunny Lee.
Yes.
And before that, it was Down the Train Line along with Patsy Todd on that one.
Yes.
That one's Dr. Bird label, right?
I think so. You have so many songs that come out and so many... labels, but that one was produced by Missona Pattinger.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Right. And of course, at the top, it was Rough and Tough for Treasure Isle.
Yes.
I'd like to ask you about those days. I believe that was 1962, Rough and Tough.
Definitely.
So this is, we're going back in Jamaican music right now. On this show, we tend to play from the Rocksteady era onwards. Mm-hmm. We don't go back so far all that often.
Yes.
But I'd like to ask, what was it like? We hear these studios about Duke Reid having a gun in the studios of Treasure Isle and this sort of thing. What was it like recording for Duke Reid back in these days?
Well, Duke Reid didn't take his gun in the studio because he wants someone to be afraid of him. But he is a man that ran a big liquor store in Jamaica, and then he always has his gun, maybe to protect his business, really, you know?
Right.
I heard a story once that he fired a shot in the studio, but I think because he was so happy to hear the music, that's my knowledge of it, really.
Right.
But he's a great and a very nice person.
Well, let me go back a little bit further and ask you how you first came to sing. Even before you went in the studio, how did you become a singer?
Well, I've told this story so many times, but I'm going to keep on telling the story as long as I live. It started in school, really, you know?
Mm-hmm.
They had this end of year term, and my friends always hear me singing a lot of songs, and they thought I could really sing. So at the end of the school term, they said I should sing for my class, really.
Right.
So I went up and I sang a song called Tell Me Darling that was done by Wilfred Jackie Edwards, the late Wilfred Jackie Edwards, and they gave me a clap.
Right.
And said it was good and asked me to sing another one. So I sing another Jackie Edwards song called I Know. And at the end of the party, they gave me two ice cream. So that's where it really started.
Right.
Then I was encouraged that I should try to make some record. So I always been writing song and all of that, you know?
Right.
And my brother was the number one disc jockey for Joe Creed sound system. His name is Leroy Cole, otherwise known as Cuttings. So with the strength of my brother working with Mr. Reed, I had the strength to go and rehearse for Mr. Reed.
Okay, so was he the first producer that you
yes,
voiced for?
Yes, he the very first producer. Right. And my first song that I made with Treasure Wild was called Two Little Blackbirds Sat on a Wall, which was called In and Out the Window. That was sung by Monty Morris. And when I sung that song for him, he told me that he think that was a big song, and he think he had other artists who he think could put it over better than I could.
Right.
So he asked me if I could give it to Monty Morris to sing it, and he would put my name on it as the writer. And this was my first opportunity, so I grabbed it.
Right.
And that song went number one. So after that song went number one, he said, since I could write so much, he think I could sing too. So he told me that he wanted me to sing on the other session coming up. And he would love me to sing with a lady called Patsy, mm-hmm. who used to sing with Derek Morgan.
Right.
So on that session, I sung Rough and Tough, and I sung When I Call Your Name with Patsy. So I got three number one songs in my first outing.
Right, that's pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
Well, back in the, I mean, these days, you know, everybody knows that if you make it in Jamaican music, you make a name for yourself all over the world.
Definitely.
But back in those days, it was a bit different, you know. You know, did you ever have any idea when you were first voicing these songs for Duke Reed that, you know, all these decades later, you would be traveling the world singing these same songs?
No, I did not know. I'm at a great surprise these days, that because I'm traveling all over the world now for the past 6-7 years now, and it's like it's only getting much better, you know.
Right.
When Moss come on, he'll tell you some story, because we are organizing some tours for Europe and all over the world and things like that. So
yep.
I'm very excited to know what I've done 40 and 50 years ago is now paying off.
Yeah. Well, mm-hmm. speaking of paying off, I mean, we always hear stories about the early days of Jamaican music, especially the producers, you know, just giving an artist a food money, a little token sum for
it's
to voice.
Like working in a factory. You know, you work every week for a week's pay. So
right.
there's a lot of songs that I've sung, I don't even remember them, because when I do a song or two songs, I put that behind me and try to make two more so that I could get another pay check the other weekend coming.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, it's still like that these days. I know from, you know, working with different artists, modern artists in the dub plate studio, some of them can't remember half of the tunes.
Yes.
If they just get paid, you know, money from a producer.
Yeah. Then that's it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let me go into another song right now. This next one is one of my favorites. It's you singing alongside Kim Booth. Of course, I'm talking about Arta Bella.
Yes.
This one was for Coxon, though, Studio One?
No, it wasn't for Coxon. It was done for another underground producer, but it was given to Coxon to distribute.
I see.
Yes.
I see. Well, look, we've played a couple combinations. Before we get into this, I just wanted to ask, one of the things that I heard was that you used to voice a lot of combinations when you first started because you were kind of shy. Is that true?
Yes, I'm still shy, you know? Yes, you know, I love to sing with people because I love harmonious sound, you know. I love harmony, you know. Mm-hmm. So in the early days, I sing a lot with other people.
Right.
Yes.
All right. Well, this is Arta Bella right now on PBS. You're listening to Babylon Burning. Jesse I alongside Stranger Cole in the studio today. Yes, that's the voice of Stranger Cole. One of my all-time favorite songs, I got to say. A big, big tune there, Crying Every Night. And you were just telling me that that one voiced in the Treasure Isle Studios.
Yes, and it was produced by a man called Byron Smith, an engineer for Treasure Isle.
Okay. Mm-hmm. What year was that?
I don't remember. Right. There's a lot of things I don't remember, you know?
Yeah, well, yeah. Well, I can't argue with that. There's a lot of things I
maybe
don't remember.
Maybe Max can tell you, because he is the music man, really, you know?
It's around 68 or something, 68, 69.
Thank you very much,
there we
Moss.
Go.
Yes.
Feel free to stay on the mic there, Moss. Yeah. Of course, that is the voice of Moss Raxlen. He's out here with Stranger.
M-O-S-S, it's Moss.
Yep, or am I pronouncing it wrong?
Sounds like you said Max or something.
No, I don't think so.
It's the accent.
Yeah, it must be. But of course, let me just ask you real quick. I mean, you know rocksteady and early reggae music pretty well, to say the least. Of course, you produced the film Rocksteady that you were out here with not long ago last year. Right. And tonight, of course, you're playing a set after Stranger Cole and all of the bands tonight at the Corner Hotel.
Yep.
Tell us about what you're going to play.
Ska, rocksteady, mashups, dub plates, unreleased tracks, lots of exclusive and rare stuff, and stuff you probably won't be hearing again anytime soon. Again, maybe next year when I come around with Sister Nancy, maybe. But I'll probably be bringing a whole bunch of other stuff.
Sounds good. So, of course, tonight it's the Melbourne Rocksteady Ska and Reggae Review. We have Stranger Cole playing an hour and a half of hits, the flyer says, backed by the Moonhops, which is a classic Melbourne Rocksteady band that are reuniting just for tonight. We also have the Ska Vendors, Johnny Longshot, Skaz, with guests the Melburnians, also Judge Pino and the Ruling Motions. I saw them for the first time a couple of weeks ago, and they're wicked.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, I'll be spinning some tunes there, along with Mohair Slim and Moss as well.
Yes, but Jesse, hi.
Yeah, that's me.
Yeah.
So I wanted to just keep talking about your early career back in the 70s. Yeah. I understand you immigrated to England fairly early.
To Canada.
So you went to Canada. You didn't, because
I've been to England, but just on a tour in the late 60s,
right,
like 1970 so.
Right.
But I migrated to Canada about 1973, and I lived there for about 12 years.
Right.
But I'm now back in Jamaica.
Right. So what made you decide to leave Jamaica back at that time?
Well, you know, I'm an adventurer, you know, and I love to explore, you know. Mm-hmm. And in the early days in Jamaica music, it wasn't like today. A lot of money wasn't making on music, really. So I got the opportunity to go to Canada, and I think it was a good thing for me and my family. So I migrate to Canada.
Right. Mm-hmm. What about returning to Jamaica? I mean, was it did you feel like the island had changed a great deal in the time you were away?
Well, you know, yes, a lot of things have changed. Bob Marley opened the gate of reggae music, and mm-hmm. there was so much thing happening for reggae music in Jamaica, and I was asked to come back home and thing like that, and I decided to go back to Jamaica. And it was very overwhelming for me, because my first show I appeared on in Jamaica, it was the visiting of Nelson Mandela and in the stadium in Jamaica, and I sang Rough and Tough, which they would say tore down the house.
Mm-hmm.
And then my friend says I should stay in Jamaica because I am still loved there and thing. So I listened to them and decided to stay in Jamaica.
Right.
And here I am today.
Right. How do you find, you know, life in Jamaica these days? I mean, the music business is completely different to what have been like back then.
It's completely different from the early days of my beginning, but I would say music is music, and I think it's all good, because if a guy can buy his mother a house and put food on his table and all of that, I think that's the best part of it. So I'm gonna be saluting that part of it. For the music, really, I think it has been watered down, and you're not getting that orchestration like mm-hmm. I had in the early days with the Scatterlite and all of that, but overall, it's good because a lot of money is in it
right
these days.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. One thing that I've noticed, I mean, you know, in, during the 90s, obviously a lot of digital rhythms and production was there.
Yes.
But the one-drop reggae rhythms were still being made. You had producers like yes. Digital B mm-hmm. and Exterminator making one-drop real reggae music.
Yes.
These days, it seems like it's becoming more and more rare. Apart from Donovan Germain, Penthouse, and maybe Jukebox, there aren't yeah. many producers making roots rhythms anymore.
Not
in Jamaica.
Really. I think most of the later music nowadays is kind of going towards the Trinidadian calypso style, really, which is dancehall, you know.
Mm.
But you cannot get out the original music, which is rocksteady and reggae and ska. I think these music live on because here I am
yeah.
still doing it for 40 years and all of that. So it really lives, you know.
Yeah, like mm-hmm. those kind of rhythms can't dead. They're always going to be there.
Yes, for sure.
I just want to ask you, when you're in Canada, obviously you never stopped recording. So
no.
I was about to play a song now from a CD called Glory, Dominion, Majesty and Power.
Mm-hmm.
It's on the PK label, but it's a reissue from the Half Moon label.
Yes.
So can you tell us about these recordings?
Yes, I did these recording when I was living with Canada. The musician was from a band called Super 8 in Chalawa, and it was done for the Half Moon Studio in Canada.
Right. Well, I'm going to play a tune now called Freedom, Justice and Equality, and we'll be back with more. You're on PBS. PBS FM. You're listening to Babylon Burning with Jesse I, and in the studio, Stranger Cole and the man called Moss Raxlen. Welcome, and it's a big show coming up tonight.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to it. It's a nice little end there. The past couple shows were nice, but this is like going to be probably the best one. So it's nice to end the little South Pacific tour on a nice note, a fun note. Being back here in Melbourne, it was a lot of fun last time for sure.
Yeah. Tell us just real quick about the other shows you've done. You played in Sydney last weekend.
Sydney and then Auckland for the first time. Stranger got mad at me last time because
yes,
I went by myself to New Zealand, and then when I finally met up with Stranger over here, he's like, Moss, what's going on? What? I was like, okay, I'll try and set up something next year. So actually, our coming back here was just like also working with what was going on in New Zealand. So it was just like, first there was the interest to get Stranger and me back there in New Zealand, and then I was like, okay, that was set. So then I made some contacts here. Lucius set up, Hellstatic set up, Sydney, and then Melbourne was set up. Lloydie was totally into doing it again. So it was a nice happenstance that everything kind of came together again.
That's good.
And then we'll be going back in a few days on Monday, flying back. We'll be in L.A. Stranger will be there for one night, and I'll be there for a couple nights. Maybe we'll meet up again and go see Roger Steffens, our old friend Roger Steffens.
Yep.
Then I head back, and in a couple weeks I take off to Indianapolis to do a gig with Sister Nancy. I guess I'm working. She's another artist I'm working a lot with, and do that. And then a couple weeks after with Chicago with her. And around that same time, getting back to Jamaica, meeting up with Stranger again, and setting up for Stranger to go back to the States, like San Fran, San Diego, L.A., maybe New Orleans, so a bunch of stuff. In Montreal, maybe Toronto, get him. I know he'd like to get there, and his family would like to see him that's up there in Canada. So setting up some stuff up for spring, summer for Stranger as well. And then around summertime, end of summertime, beginning of the fall, I'll be heading out to Europe, setting stuff up for Stranger and maybe Dawn and a bunch of other artists to do like a month and a half long tour that'll start around end of September, beginning of October there in Europe. And so traveling around and basically just keeping it going from there and trying maybe to get some reissue stuff going on as well, some of the beautiful old tracks that Stranger had produced himself. Stranger was smart enough he was really smart enough to actually, when Rocksteady kind of started producing his own material, and it was really smart of him because he was fortunate enough to get some nice kickbacks from actually his productions. Unfortunately, it was sad that at the time what was going on was a lot of bootlegging. So all these really nice songs that got made in Jamaica, what would happen was they would get sent to England and they'd just bootleg them. Mm-hmm. And it was really unfortunate. But now with my research and stuff and help of other collectors, kind of bringing those up and making sure that Stranger gets his proper dues for those and getting them released properly.
Right.
So working on that too for the, I guess, end of the year and stuff. So all these different projects and doing what I can to help out these foundation artists who definitely deserve all the help and publicity, and you know, these guys, a lot of them, they're not really well known, but they definitely deserve all the help and all the promotion they can get, for sure.
That's true. I mean, we're just as I mentioned at the start of the show, Ja Woosh just recently passed away, not a mention in the Jamaican newspapers whatsoever.
Yeah.
Then you hear stories. I remember when Iroy died, must be about 10 years ago now, but
that was very sad. He was a crackhead. That was kind of, it went really bad. That was really, he in the 80s when that came around, and it went, he got involved with that, and it was quite sad.
Right.
Stranger had a story for me, but I won't repeat it. But it was to do with how bad he was, and it was quite sad. He was actually living on the street.
That's what I heard. Yeah,
and it's really sad. It ruined a lot of people's lives there in Jamaica. To this day, it's quite extreme, to the point of 12-year-old kids with AK-47s selling it on the street corners and killing each other.
Yep. So it's very good to see a man like Stranger Cole getting the recognition that he deserves after all these years and still touring the world. And of course, tonight, if you haven't seen him yet, even if you saw him last time, you want to come out again tonight. Stranger Cole playing with the Moonhops tonight at the Corner Hotel alongside the Scar Vendors, Johnny Longshot, Skaz and the Melburnians, Judge Pino and the Ruling Motions. And I'll be there spinning some vinyl alongside Mohair Slim and Moss himself. So please come out tonight to the Corner Hotel. Stranger, is there anything else you guys want to tell the Melbourne listeners before the show tonight?
Well, I got a lot of fans here in Melbourne. You know, it seems as if I'm going to become a citizen of Australia, really, you know. But I would love to send all my love and more life to a lot of my friends who is coming from Sydney and New Zealand and all over. Yeah. And most of all to Andrea Macris, which is my main friend, you know, which is Lydie's wife, you know.
Right, right.
Yeah, she is the one who pushed me around. So I want to say hi to her and more life.
Yeah, and thanks to all the people in Australia. I know lots of people are flying in from other parts of Australia for the concert. So thank to everybody here in Melbourne, but also to everybody in Australia for all the help, all the support. Thanks for everyone coming out. Yeah.
All right. Well, thanks to you guys for coming into the studios of PBS today. Nice to have you here.
It's a pleasure.
Pleasure.
All right. Give thanks.
Thanks.
Stranger Cole with Moss Raxlen speaking to me there back in March 2011. That's it for this episode. If you enjoyed the podcast and you want to support it, you can become a patron at patreon.com for as little as a few bucks a month. On that note, please be aware, if you happen to use the Patreon iOS app, in other words, if you use the Patreon app on an Apple product like an iPhone or an iPad, Apple have recently announced that from November onwards, all payments will be forced via the iTunes shop, which takes a 30% cut. The default for Patreon will just be to add that percentage on top. So basically, if you were to sign up as a patron of somebody for $10 a month, you'd actually be charged $13 a month, with the extra $3 going straight to Apple, if you sign up via the Patreon app for iOS. Just to be clear, this is only for people who join Patreon via the app for Apple. So if you're an iPhone user, you can always just use your web browser to go to the Patreon website and sign up there and avoid the charge. Obviously, this won't affect any Android users or PC users in the slightest, but Apple is a super shit company and I wouldn't want to give them a single dollar, so please, don't do it. Anyway, big up my Patreon brethren and sister, the Don Armageddon Time, the Real General Empress Irie, me Idrin Tom Tanaki, and me Chargy DJ Publito. Thanks for listening. Eyes is every time.